Welcome at the Bible study of the Free Reformed Church of Kelmscott. Tonight we will study the second part of Revelation 1, verse 4 to 8. Before we start the Bible study, let us pray together. Our Father in heaven, we come before you to ask your blessing over this Bible study. Will you provide us insight in your word in the Revelation, so that we may understand what your will is for our lives, and that we may also apply it to our own lives. Give us that we may be encouraged and strengthened by that, and that it may encourage us to stand firm in faith and to resist the attacks of the evil one. Father, bless us when we will go through this Bible study. Bless us also when we discuss it together with each other, that we all may do it to the glory of your name. We pray this in the name of your Son, the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Let's read Revelation 1, verse 4 to 8. John, to the seven churches which are in Asia, grace to and peace from him who is and who was and who is to come, and from the seven spirits who are before his throne, and from Jesus Christ, the faithful witness, the firstborn from the dead, and the ruler over the kings of the earth. To him who loved us and washed us from our sins in his own blood, and has made us kings and priests to his God and Father, to him be glory and dominion for ever and ever. Amen. Behold, he is coming with clouds, and every eye will see him, even they who pierced him. And all the tribes of the earth will mourn because of him. Even so. Amen. I am the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end, says the Lord, who is and who was and who is to come, the Almighty. In verse 4, we read about John, who writes to the seven churches which are in Asia. It is from John, who wrote it at the command of Jesus Christ, as we saw in the previous Bible study, the verses 1 to 3. Just like the other books of the Bible, also this one is ultimately from God. It is made explicit in the introduction. We will hear more about John in verse 9, where he speaks about himself as being at Patmos. There also we will hear more about the time of the writing of this book. I know some of you have asked for that in the previous Bible study, but that will come next week. Revelation is given in series of seven, and here we read about the seven churches in Asia. The number seven is symbolic. It indicates a completeness. When God created the heavens and the earth, he created in 6 days, and the seventh day completed the week, the seventh day, the day of rest. And with that, God instituted the order of 7 days in a week. And since then, the week has always had 7 days. Mankind has not been able to change that. If you look at the months are arranged according to the moon. In the time of Israel, a month often had 30 days. However, in our time, we changed that. Months have either 31 days or 30 days. And one month has 28 days or sometimes 29. So we see that that could be changed over time. However, the week has never been changed. It is one of the basic principles in God's creation. So seven is an important number. It's a number of God's fullness, God's completeness. The number of seven we see coming back throughout the book of Revelation time and again. This brings us to numbers in general in the book of Revelation. There are other numbers which are important. The number three is the number of the Trinity, the three persons in the one God. The number four, it's about the four corners of the earth. God created this earth with four corners, or as we say, with north, east, south, and west. Then we have the number 12 of 12 tribes of Israel and the New Testament, the 12 apostles. And together they are 24, a number which we will see coming back as well. And last week we heard about the number 1,000. Thousands means a complete time period, a very long time. And last week we saw the 1,000 years in Revelation 20 refers to the end time. And then we can talk about the number 7, which is 3 plus 4. In chapter 6, we read about the first four seals, which are the four horses that forms the unity. And then in chapter 8, after the first four trumpets, then we hear about the three angels that will still blow the trumpets, which are being called the three woes. These numbers in Revelation show God's order. God is a God of order, and he created this creation according to his order. And those numbers being used in Revelation show us that also the history, also the future, all that is happening on this earth, it happens in good order. It is not chaos, it is not a coincidence. But God has a purpose with it all. It all follows his order. It is all God's work. Also, the future will be God's work. And that may give us a certainty that nothing happens by chance. No, it all happens as part of God's plan. Here we read about the seven churches. These seven churches are specific churches. They are mentioned in verse 11. And chapter 2 and 3, we will see that Christ addresses these churches with their own strengths and their own weaknesses. Christ is speaking, Christ is writing to specific churches, existing churches. At the same time, the seven together, the number seven indicates a fullness, a completeness, and they refer to the entire Church of Christ, the Holy Catholic Church. So these seven churches are representative of the entire Church. The message of Jesus Christ, which John sends to the seven churches, is relevant for the Church of all times and all places. It starts with the self-examination for the church in chapter 2 and 3, and then thereafter it is full of encouragement for the church to remain faithful in a time that God's warnings and God's judgments are going over the earth. Now, talking about those seven specific churches with Christ's message to each of the churches individually, that also brings forward a question which you could discuss tonight. The question is, why is it important for every church to have its own minister of the word? Why could we not say, especially in this situation of live streaming and the time that we cannot come together in our church buildings, why can we not say, let us all watch one live stream from one church, one minister in federation, and that saves the other ministers a lot of time? Why is it important that every church watches their own live stream, listens to their own minister? And can we learn something from how Christ addresses each of the seven churches? We continue with the next verse, which speaks about grace to you and peace. God is a God of peace for his people. His grace comes to us and not his wrath. It is important for the church to know this, because this is an encouragement for the church. God speaks about wrath and judgments in this book, but first of all, of grace and peace to his church. We are God's people. We may receive his grace and peace. There is no need to fear. And that is what God says to his people right away at the beginning of this book. Grace and peace to you. And then from him who is and who was and who is to come. This reminds us of God in Exodus 3 revealing himself to Moses and the people of Israel as the God who is who he is. I am who I am. He is faithful. He is the one who does not change, who remains the same, the one who was in the past, who is now, and will always be. He was there for the fathers, Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. He is there for Israel in Egypt. He is there for his people always. And then he who is to come. It's remarkable that he says who is to come and not the one who will always be. He is actively working to fulfill his plan, actively working towards the return of Jesus Christ. It doesn't say that he will always be the same, always the static God who never changes, which will speak about an endless circle of life, the endless tiring circle of reincarnation. No, that is not what is said here. No, God works towards his goal. He is driving this world to the end. And it will come to an end. The end which he has determined in his plan. And we expect his coming. We expect the day that he will make all things new. This name of God is full of certainty and full of hope. Then he speaks about the seven spirits before his throne. Again, the number seven, which means a completeness. The spirit that is the seven spirits, that is the Holy Spirit. He is everywhere present. He can be everywhere present. He can fill the entire earth. This is different from how Satan is. Satan is a creature. And as a creature, he cannot be everywhere present, even though he can send out his demons all over the earth. But they are still creatures. The Spirit of God is not a creature. God is everywhere present. His Spirit is everywhere. Wherever Christ gathers his church, there his Spirit works. And then it speaks about Jesus Christ, a faithful witness, the firstborn from the dead and a ruler over the kings of the earth. Jesus Christ is the faithful witness. He is faithful, that means he speaks the truth. He testified and preached the Father's love for us. He is the fullness of God's revelation to us, God's revelation of love. He was faithful during his entire life in fulfilling the task which he had received from the Father. The word witness in Greek is a word that we also have in our English language, the martyr, martyrion. The witness, the martyr, he witnesses by even giving his own life. Coming Friday, we will remember on Good Friday the suffering and death of our Lord Jesus Christ. He who gave his life so that he could show God's love for us. God's love for us became most clear in Christ being willing to suffer eternal death in our place so that he could redeem us from the power of sin and the power of hell. And we can receive life with him and live with God. And later we see that the followers of Jesus Christ also are witnesses, faithful witnesses, following Jesus Christ, taking up their cross. They give a testimony, and they do so by not loving their own life, but being willing to give up their own lives. And John himself was at Patmos for the testimony, for the martyrium of Jesus Christ. So the theme of the martyr is one of the themes of this book. We obtain the victory by being witnesses, by being martyrs. Jesus Christ obtained the victory through his death. We also will obtain the victory not by loving our own lives, not loving our lives even unto death. We are willing to give up our life because we want to be one with Jesus Christ. And this theme of being martyr comes back several times in Revelation. And he is called the firstborn from the dead. That refers to his victory. He rose from the dead. He rose as firstborn, as the first one. Firstborn in the Bible means he is the first one, but not the only one. More will follow, and that contains a promise for us. We will be raised with him to a new life. And then he is the ruler over the kings of the earth. He, to him is given all authority in heaven and on earth, as he said to his disciples in Matthew 28. And then he sent them out as his apostles all over the earth to proclaim his kingdom and to make all nations to his disciples. So Satan is no longer the ruler of the earth, the prince of this world, but Jesus Christ. He has received all authority in heaven and on earth. And that is also why Satan could be hurled down from heaven in Revelation 12, because there's no place for him anymore in heaven. Here again, I have a couple questions. The first question in verse 5, it speaks about witnessing, it speaks about a martyr, and that is about suffering. The book of Revelation is given to the church to prepare her for and encourage her in the sufferings that come over her. These are sufferings for the sake of Christ and are part of the life of the church on earth. However, the churches here in Australia in our time haven't seen a whole lot of suffering yet. How do we have to see this? Should we expect more suffering, or is it because we shy away from witnessing out of fear for suffering? Or is there something else that we should consider here? Another question. At the moment, as a result of the government measures regarding the virus, we suffer a little bit of what our brothers and sisters in China and other countries are suffering, not being able to meet together except in small groups. They suffer even more because we still have the freedom to profess our faith openly and we can follow our services through live stream. Nevertheless, how does this present situation influence the way you appreciate the fellowship which we may experience on Sundays? How important is the fellowship with each other for you? Do you miss that fellowship now that we only have the live stream? Then we continue the Bible study. Then we read, to him who loved us. The love of Christ for his church becomes very clear throughout this book. Christ already showed his love for us by his suffering and death. He was willing to give up his own life for us to save us. Paul says in Romans 8, God who did not spare his own son but gave him up for us all, will he not also with him graciously give us all things? Here in Revelation it is Jesus Christ himself who shows his love for us. He gave his own life for us. Now he will certainly not let us be robbed out of his hand by Satan. The church is precious to him. He will protect and defend her. And he washed us from our sins in his own blood. This sets the church apart from the world. In chapter 7, verse 14, there we read about the great multitude that no one can count. About them it is said that they washed their robes white in the blood of the Lamb. And also in other parts we read that the church that are the ones who are righteous. Chapter 14, chapter 19. And he has made us kings and priests to God, to his God and Father. And that reminds us of 1 Peter 2, verse 9, where it is said that we are a royal priesthood, a holy nation, that you may proclaim the excellencies of him who called you out of darkness into his marvelous light. And 1 Peter 2, verse 9 comes again from the Old Testament, in Exodus 19, verse 6, where God says, you shall be to me a kingdom of priests, a holy nation. And that is the purpose of our calling. That's the purpose of our redemption. Christ redeemed us so that we may be a holy nation, a priesthood for God to proclaim his glory. Because to him be glory and dominion forever and ever. Amen. Everything is to the glory of God. Our redemption, our calling, but also the punishment which comes over the unbelievers. It all is to the glory of God. And verse 7, behold, he is coming with clouds, and every eye will see him, even they who pierced him, and all the tribes of the earth will mourn because of him. Even so, amen. The Lord Jesus is coming. That is an assurance that the Lord has not forgotten us, his church. He will come with the clouds. At his ascension, a cloud took him out of their sight. And there it was promised to the disciples that the Lord who was taken up from them would come back in the same way. That is, with the clouds. And that is being referred to here in this verse. This verse also refers to Daniel 7, verse 13. Where Daniel saw in a vision someone who came with the clouds of heaven, someone, a son of man, and he came to the Ancient of Days. Son of man, the Lord Jesus Christ often speaks about himself as the Son of Man. And the Ancient of Days, that refers to God, the God who is and who was and who is to come. And to this Son of Man who came with the clouds of heaven, to him was given dominion. Now this is what happened on the day of ascension, when the Lord Jesus Christ ascended into heaven, him was given dominion over all creation. And he will come again as the judge to judge the living and the dead, the one who is given all dominion, all authority. And the clouds indeed refers to the authority, to the glory which he has. And all tribes of the earth, every eye will see him, even they who pierced him. All the tribes of the earth will mourn because of him. They will all recognize him. They will all be scared. They will in fear beat their own chest. They will mourn, they will wail, because they recognize him as the one whom they first rejected, but who now comes on the clouds of heaven with great authority to judge the living and the dead. Yes, amen, it says here then, or even so in a translation, even so, amen. That is both the Greek word as well as the Hebrew word for it is certain, it is sure. And verse 8, I am the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end, says the Lord who is and who was and who is to come, the Almighty. The Alpha and the Omega, the first and the last letter of the Greek alphabet. This encompasses all that is in between. He is the beginning and the end. He is the creator and the one who brings everything to fulfillment. He is, he was, he is to come. He is the Almighty. These words, Alpha and Omega, beginning and end, are being repeated in verse 11. And that's important also for the rest of the book. The whole history and the future are in his hands. Everything has an origin, everything has a goal. It is all from God and to God. And with this, we will end the Bible study for today. You can discuss the questions, you can discuss your own questions, and if there are some questions to which you don't have an answer, you can send me your questions at 8 o'clock. I'm available today, it's 7th of April. I'm available online to answer the questions which are still left. And I hope this Bible study, as well as the discussion, will be a blessing to you.